welcome to our channel. My name is Niti, and I'm a part of the Exactpro research team. At Exactpro, we build software to test software. Do check out our website if you want to learn more about us. And please subscribe and hit that bell button to make sure you see the upcoming videos. We are continuing our series based on the ISTQB Certified Tester AI Testing Syllabus. Today, we will review Chapter 3, called Machine Learning. In the previous videos, we learned about the basic concept of AI and its requirements. We have also talked about supervised learning, unsupervised learning, and reinforcement learning. And now, we are ready to get acquainted with the AI implementation algorithm. Let's go over the workflow. First of all, we need to understand the objectives. All stakeholders need to agree on the purpose and the acceptance criteria of the ML model to ensure alignment with business priorities. Second of all, a suitable AI development framework should be selected based on the aforementioned objectives, acceptance criteria, and business priorities. Then, we select and build a machine learning algorithm. It may be coded manually, but is often retrieved from a library of pre-written code. The algorithm is then compiled to prepare it for training the model if needed. After that, data preparation is required. This process consists of data acquisition, data pre-processing, exploratory data analysis, and feature engineering. The data used by the model will be based on the set objectives and used by all activities in the model generation and test phase. For example, if we have a real-time trading system, we will require market data, which must be representative. It is also possible to use pre-gathered datasets for the initial training. Otherwise, raw data typically will demand some pre-processing, feature engineering, and testing. The machine learning algorithm uses data to train the model. Some algorithms, such as those generating a neural network, have to read the training dataset several times. Each iteration is called an epoch. Parameters defining the structure and controlling the training are passed to the model, and they are called model hyperparameters. Then, we evaluate the model. The machine learning functional performance metrics are assessed using the validation dataset, thus trying to improve the model. Model evaluation and tuning should resemble a carefully conducted scientific experiment with controlled conditions and clear documentation. In practice, several models are typically created and trained using different algorithms, and then the best one is chosen. After that, we tune the model. The results from the model evaluation are used to adjust the settings to fit the data and improve its performance. The model may also be tuned by adjusting hyperparameters, where the training activity is modified by changing the number of training steps, or the amount of data used for training, or by updating attributes of the model. The three activities of training, evaluation, and tuning help to generate the model. Then we test the model. Once the model has been generated, it should be tested against an independent test dataset to ensure that the agreed machine learning functional performance criteria are met. If the performance of the model with independent data is significantly lower than what it was during evaluation, it may be necessary to select a different model. In addition to functional performance tests, non-functional tests, such as estimating the time to train the model and the time and resource usage taken to provide prediction, also need to be run. Typically, these tests are performed by data scientists, but testers with sufficient knowledge of the domain can help here as well. The next step is model deployment. Once development is complete, the tuned model typically needs to be re-engineered for deployment along with its related resources, including the relevant data pipeline. This is normally achieved through the framework. Targets may include embedded systems and the cloud, where the model can be accessed via a web API. After that, we use the model. Once deployed, the model becomes a part of a larger AI-based system. It may perform scheduled batch predictions at specified time intervals or run on request in real time. And lastly, we monitor and tune the model. While the model is being used, its conditions may evolve, and the model may drift away from what's intended. To ensure that any drift is identified and managed, the operational model should be regularly evaluated against its acceptance criteria. It may require the adjustment of the model settings to address the drift, or retraining with new updated data to create a more accurate and robust model. The new model may then be compared against the existing model, for example, using a form of A/B testing. The machine learning workflow shown here is a logical sequence just like the waterfall model. In practice, the workflow steps are repeated iteratively, just like with iterative lifecycle models. Usually, the key point here lies in the testing phase of the model. If the model shows low or insufficient results at this stage, a decision may be made to change the model, return to the select and build a machine learning algorithm step. It may also be that the data was originally not sufficiently examined and prepared, and not all of the model features useful for learning have been selected. If so, the specialist will return to the data preparation step, and the whole process will be repeated, and this may happen several times. Please mind that the phases shown here do not include the integration of the machine learning model with the non-machine learning parts of the overall system. If the model is a part of a larger AI-based system, it will need to be integrated into the system prior to the deployment. In this case, integration, system, and acceptance test levels may be performed. Let's look at how one can select an appropriate machine learning approach based on the nature of the task at hand. The first question we need to ask ourselves is, do we have structured training data? If not, the next question is, do we have rules for rewarding and penalizing? If our answer is, again, no, our task might not be applicable for machine learning at all. But if those rules do exist, then reinforcement learning may be applied. Let's go back to the question about the structured data. Now, if our answer is yes, then it takes us to another question. Do we have labeled data? If our answer is no, we have to ask ourselves if the problem involves grouping similar data. If the answer is yes, it may be clustering. If the answer is no, then we ask if the problem involves finding co-occurring data items, which may be an association. Both clustering and association point to unsupervised learning. Let's go back to the question about labeled data. If our answer is yes, then we ask a question if the output data is categorical. If the output is discrete and categorical, it may be classified. If the output is numeric and continuous in nature, it may be regression. Regression and classification suggest there is an output label, which means it may be supervised learning. There is no definitive approach on how to choose an optimal machine learning algorithm, model settings, and model hyperparameters. In practice, this set is chosen based on a mix of the following factors. Number 1, the required functionality. Number 2, the required quality characteristics. Number 3, the type of data available for training the model. Number 4, the amount of data available for training and testing the model. Number 5, the number of attributes in the input data expected to be used by the model. Number 6, the expected number of groups for clustering. Number 7, previous experience. And number 8, a trial and error method. As we have learned earlier, when a machine learning expert chooses the best model, he or she looks at quality indicators, among other things, which may lead to several possible scenarios. The first situation is overfitting. Overfitting is when a model performs well on a training dataset, but as soon as new data becomes available, the quality of predictions deteriorates significantly. It can also occur when insufficient data is provided in the training dataset. The second situation occurs when the model performs poorly on both the training data and the new data. This situation is called underfitting. Underfitting occurs when the model is not sophisticated enough to accurately fit to the patterns in the training data. And the third situation is when the model is equally good at predicting both training and new data. This, of course, is the best case scenario. And that's it for this video. If you liked it, give us a thumbs up. In the next one, we will be talking about Chapter 4, titled Machine Learning Data. As always, let me remind you that we do have a ton more awesome videos on our channel. So, feel free to subscribe and hit that bell button. Thanks for watching, and see you soon!